pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Gentlemen, there is no longer any ground for hope. If we wish to be free, if we wish to preserve inviolate those inestimable privileges which belong to us as free men, if we mean not basely to abandon the noble struggle in which we have been so long engaged, in which we have pledged ourselves never to abandon until the glorious object of our struggle be obtained, then we must fight.
Hey, I repeat it, sir.
We must fight. And the real hope and to the God of hosts is all we have left us.
Arms, Mr. Henry.
What arms? They tell us, sir, that we are weak, unable to cope with so powerful an adversary. But when shall we be stronger? Will it be the next week? Or the next year? Will it be when we are totally disarmed and a British guard shall be stationed in every house? Shall we acquire the means of effectual resistance by lying supinely on our backs, hugging the delusive phantom of hope until our enemy hath bound us hand and foot? Sir, we are not weak. If we make a proper use of those means the God of nature hath placed in our power, 3 millions of people, armed in the holy cause of liberty, and in such a country that which we possess, are invincible by any force our enemy can send against us. Besides, sir, we shall not fight our battles alone. There is a just God who presides over the destinies of nations, who will raise up friends to fight our battles for us. The battle, sir, is not to the strong alone. It is to the vigilant, the active, the brave. Besides, sir, we have no election. Should we be base enough to desire it, it is now already too late to retire from the contest. There is no retreat, but in submission and slavery. Our chains are forged, their clanking may be heard upon the plains of Boston. The war is inevitable, and let it come. I repeat it, sir, let it come!
Release me for peace, sir!
It is in vain to extenuate the matter. Gentlemen may cry, peace, peace, but there is no peace. The war is actually begun. The next gale that blows from the north shall bring to our ears the clash of resounding arms. Our brethren are already in the field. Why stand we here idle? What is it that they wish? What would they have? Is life so dear? Or peace so sweet as to be purchased at the price of chains and slavery? Forbid it, Almighty God! I know not what course others may take. But as for me, give me liberty, or give me death!
Does the government work for us, or do we work for the government? Are true patriots guided by symbolism such as flag waving and pledges, or by their commitment to personal freedoms? Tonight, summer soldiers and summertime patriots. At this 4th of July, we pause to remember the birth of this great country. It is a story every school child knows. The British government taxed us without representation. It devalued our currency. It sent its soldiers into our homes without legal search warrants. And it punished us for criticizing the British king. The first law enacted by the first U.S. Congress, while we were still subject to the king, was the Declaration of Independence. It's still the law today. It declares that our freedoms come from our humanity, which is a gift from God. They don't come from the government. The British king believed that our freedoms came from him. And he claimed the power to expand them or shrink them as he saw fit. Enough was enough. We fought a revolution. We won the revolution. We wrote a constitution. The constitution is the supreme law of the land. It was written to create and to limit the federal government. We know that because the framers famously feared big government. Thus, they added the Bill of Rights to the constitution. The Bill of Rights is intended to keep the government off our backs by making it unlawful for the government to interfere with our freedoms. Our inalienable rights, as Jefferson called them. This is not an academic argument. If the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution mean what they say, then we should be able to rely on our own free choices as we move through life on Earth, and not on the commands of the government. George Washington believed that the individual is greater than the state, because the individual has a divinely created immortal soul, and the state is a mere human creation based on force. As creatures of God and as rational thinking beings, we have a right to live and a right to exercise all of our freedoms. One of the quintessentially American freedoms is the right to be left alone, the right to be yourself, the right to be different, the right not to conform. This rite was recently played out in Eugene City, Oregon, where the governing body had a heated dust-up last week over a proposed ban on reciting the Pledge of Allegiance at the start of every town council meeting. After repeated arguments about it, a blanket ban was passed, sparking another battle that saw the mayor of the town rescind the ban to allow the pledge to be recited during national holidays. The mayor was quoted as saying this: "If there's one thing the flag stands for, it's that people don't have to be compelled to say the Pledge of Allegiance or anything else." Under the law, the mayor is right. The Pledge of Allegiance was written in 1892 by Francis Bellamy, a socialist who was hired to write the pledge to help sell American flags. It wasn't created out of some noble attempt at national unity or patriotism, but for the commercial activity so despised by today's socialists: earning money. Now, here's something they don't teach you in school. The socialist Mr. Bellamy also created a salute to accompany the pledge, but it wasn't the hand over the heart as we have today. The Bellamy salute was an extended arm, and it became very popular in the early 1900s. It was so popular, in fact, that Italian fascists and German National Socialists, we call them Nazis, appropriated it for their own salute. When President Woodrow Wilson insisted that all school children recite the pledge, he led them into doing so using this now justly hated salute. I bet you never saw a picture of him doing that. One can imagine that after World War II, the Bellamy salute that Wilson loved would quickly become very unpopular among American people who were tired of fighting fascism and socialism abroad and preparing to fight it here at home. Samuel Johnson once remarked that patriotism is often the last refuge of a scoundrel. And indeed, many of our leaders today who are really scoundrels and who swore an oath to uphold the Constitution often hide behind the flag-waving celebrations when the call to defend freedom goes up and American liberties are at risk. They often betray their solemn oaths. Just yesterday, for example, President Obama claimed he can start a war on his own in defiance of the Constitution he swore to uphold, just by declaring that dropping bombs and killing people is not a war. How then can politicians who don't respect their own oaths demand that we take an oath to a flag and question the patriotism of those who dare to be different? I believe in God and in the basic decency of all persons. I believe that America has provided the greatest venue for freedom and prosperity that the world has ever known. But if the government can ignore the Declaration of Independence and reject the Constitution, if it can force people to speak when they'd prefer to remain silent, then this great venue for freedom will pass away. On this 4th of July, I pledge my gratitude to the framers who gave us the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution, and who believed in the primacy of the individual and the inalienability of our personal freedoms. I also pray that today's politicians will soon believe the same. From New York, defending freedom.